Welcome, everyone. My name is Dr. Laura Cohen, and I'm the Executive Director of the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center at Queensborough Community College at the City University of New York. Our mission is to use the lessons of the Holocaust to educate current and future generations about the ramifications of prejudice, racism, and stereotyping. We're excited to welcome you to today's program, Holocaust Education and Transformational Learning, featuring Dr. Azadeh Alai. The Kupferberg Holocaust Center in Bayside, New York, is situated on the traditional land of Mantinecock people who continue to live here today. We offer gratitude and respect to all of the indigenous people of Turtle Island, past, present, and future, including the Lenape and Shinnecock peoples. What I just read is what we call a land acknowledgement. This is a statement recognizing that the land we all occupy in the course of our daily lives, including our schools, jobs, parks, and homes, as well as the name of towns and roads, was first inhabited by another group of people who were forcibly expelled and murdered. Today, we identify those crimes for what they are, mass atrocities and genocide. These horrors continue to have devastating political, social, psychological, economic, and environmental impacts upon and within Native American and Indigenous communities. Today's presentation is part of the KHC's 2021 National Endowment for the Humanities Colloquium entitled Incarceration, Transformation, and Paths to Deliberation During the Holocaust and Beyond. It's also connected to the KHC's newest exhibition, The Concentration Camps, Inside the Nazi System of Incarceration and Genocide. Although the KHC will not be offering tours in person for classes or outside guests this semester due to CUNY's COVID-19 campus access and social distancing protocols, you are welcome to stop by and visit the exhibition on your own. And right now, we'd like to give you a quick sneak peek. This is the largest exhibition that the KHC has ever mounted and is in keeping with the use of many multimedia bits of technology, as well as different kinds of materials that we've used and sourced from different places to evoke a sense of the concentration camp system without necessarily replicating it. And in this particular exhibition, there's now a threshold that visitors will cross using going underneath the large gates that have been installed at the front and back of the exhibition space. We're still working out some of the final adjustments and materials that will be installed. The exhibition is organized in six different sections that take visitors through the system. It includes 13 videos that were recorded with Holocaust survivors prior to the COVID pandemic beginning last March, as well as features original artifacts from some of the concentration camps and the use again of materials that we've sourced to evoke the feeling of the camp. So in this case, you're staring at wood that was sourced from an Amish farm in Pennsylvania. It has the look and feel of wood that would have been used in both the cattle cars used to deport predominantly Jewish people to concentration and execution camps. You're also seeing brick that would be evocative of ghetto walls that were created. And here you're staring at stones that we sourced from a company in Iowa that specializes in antique brick and stones. This particular wall is a transition from concentration and forced labor camps where prisoners would be forced to carry these incredibly heavy stones up and down paths for no other purpose than to torture them, and is also featured in some of the extermination camps. Here you're staring at an original 13 by 15 foot map that features 2,000 of the 44,000 concentration and extermination camps that were across Europe. The purpose of this map is to show the totality of the system of how people were deported from all parts of the continent to ultimately six extermination camps in Nazi-occupied Poland. And here toward the latter part of the exhibition, we focus on death marches, liberation, and displaced person camps. Again, we're using multimedia. In this case, there are not only testimonial videos, but we have three different slide projectors featuring a different amount of many different images from the system, from the Nazis control of Europe beginning in 1939 through the end of the war, we're focusing on different Nazi perpetrators as well as the different victim groups. This exhibition has two purposes. One, to show the totality of the system of incarceration, beginning with prisons and detention centers through concentration, forced labor, and displaced persons camps, as well as to talk about the 6 million Jewish people who were exterminated and the several million more other political prisoners, other people who were tortured and killed by the Nazis, including Polish people, Slavic people, Roma and Sinti, the LGBTQI plus population, and millions others. The back of the, or the end of the exhibition, features a writing and reflection wall that is always a signature of the KHC's exhibitions, inviting students and visitors to reflect on different themes within the exhibition, including connecting the importance of understanding of why the Holocaust remains relevant in our society. And so before we begin today, we'd like to encourage you to use the raise your hand feature that's at the bottom of your screen if you have any questions. And now it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Azadeh Alai. Dr. Alai is Assistant Associate Professor of Tenure of Psychology at Queensborough Community College here at Queensborough. Her research interests include a focus on Holocaust education and the psychology of bystander behavior during the Holocaust. Her past research has focused on the intersection of media, mass violence, warfare, and genocide. She is the author of Understanding Aggression, Psychological Origins and Approaches to Aggressive Behavior, is the faculty fellow for this year's NEH Colloquium, as well as was a scholar in residence for the KHC's 2017 NEH Colloquium. And now it's my pleasure to turn things over to Dr. Alai.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much, Laura. I had the opportunity to visit the space this week, and I literally had chills as I was walking through the space. It's such a provocative and, I really physically had a reaction when I walked through. It really reminded me about the first time that I ever went to the Holocaust Memorial Museum in DC. The same kind of feeling was evoked in terms of the physical space and the materials that were constructed and things like that. It's very, very powerful. I immediately took some of the catalogs and encouraged those students of mine that I'm teaching on campus to visit. And I invite all of you to do so as well. And it was wonderful. I had the benefit of, Victoria was there and it was just the two of us. So there was that kind of solitude of being able to walk through the space in quiet and to reflect. And it was very powerful. So I encourage all of you to visit. I wanted to start with a question that I had for all of you. Victoria, if you're able to share the first slide. Thank you. And I also, I would love for this to be a collaboration with the participants. So I find that when faculty come together, there's a great opportunity for engagement and sharing of ideas. So the first question that I started to think about as I was prepping this talk is just for a moment, a focus on this term transformation. So I wanted to pose this question to our participants of when you hear this word transformation, what does it mean to you or what does it evoke? So the reason I wanted to start with this is that the colloquium series, oh, thank you, deep change, empathy. Yeah, change in perspective. Thank you for that, Meg. The colloquium series that we're doing this academic year is entitled Incarceration, Transformation, and Paths to Liberation During the Holocaust and Beyond. And so the idea of transformation is really central to this theme. Learning and unlearning. I love that, Myrna. Thank you so much. As I started to think about it, a lot of similar kinds of terms and concepts were triggered for me. I kind of jotted down change, growth, evolution, regression even. So I think a lot of times we think of transformation as moving forward in one direction, but it's important to recognize that there could be a regression, or we can even move backwards in terms of the ways that we might transform. The real kind of theme that we wanted to evoke with this idea of transformation is the fluidity. Fluidity from a lot of perspectives, fluidity of identity, fluidity of status within a society or culture, for instance, this notion of impermanence in terms of what our status could be within a society or culture. From the perspective of our students, which we'll elaborate on shortly, this idea of maturation, potentially even volatility, because oftentimes we know that growth or maturation could be triggered by difficult or uncomfortable or even frustrating experiences, or potentially even traumas, for instance. We want our students to reflect on all the different ways that we grow, that we are capable of evolving, and to be able to connect it to the circumstances that are around us and our experiences. The theme in particular, when we look at the Holocaust, we wanted to get at what happens within a society or culture when our freedoms are restricted, with the Nazi concentration camp system, for instance, which is a big part of the exhibit that we just got a glimpse of, but also that idea of kind of change or evolution or alteration of status. So this idea of transformation is I can be in one place in my own life, or maybe even as part of a larger system where my status is one place, and then at the next moment, potentially my status could be somewhere else. To kind of turn it more towards what we're doing in the classroom, I wanted to go to the second question of what do you do to stimulate change or growth for students in the classroom? And the reason that I wanted to ask this is as I was diving into the transformational learning literature, what I realized is that many of us are engaging with pedagogical tools where we're trying to stimulate growth or change or maturation in our students, but we might not always realize it, or there might not necessarily be intention or deliberateness behind all of the practices that we're engaging in the classroom, especially since the pandemic, especially for those of us who are teaching primarily remotely. But I think nonetheless, we're actually doing more than we often realize to try to trigger that change in our students. So I would be really curious to hear your responses to what are some practices that you use in the classroom to serve as these catalysts for change or growth for our students? And again, you can participate via the chat if anyone's interested in raising their hands and speaking to this. So speaking of transition, we're transitioning now to kind of diving more deeply into the literature regarding transformational learning, or specifically change that's stimulated in the classroom. And I'm happy to speak more extensively about this. The transformational learning literature identifies that growth and maturation can be a critical and meaningful aspect of the learning process. And, you know, as is the case with maturation or growth, a lot of times this can happen in incremental steps or in progressions, for instance. The change or the growth or the catalyst, it might not necessarily trigger an immediate alteration in terms of what we observe in our students or what they share with us. Yeah, absolutely. Connecting class objectives as much as possible to students' objectives in their lives. I think that that's a great starting point. I'll talk more extensively about the critical role that application can play in the classroom. I think especially right now, we're kind of teaching under the elements with this ongoing pandemic that I don't know if any of you have experienced this, but I found that it's that much more immediate or essential to connect what we're teaching our students in the classroom to what's happening out in the world, because what's happening right now is very overwhelming for us and for our students. And so I think that if we can draw a bridge between what they're learning in the classroom and what's kind of happening out there, it can equip them with tools where they feel better able to kind of handle the stress and a lot of the changes that we're experiencing right now, I would say not just in our country, but globally as well. So for those of you who had a chance to look at the reading after you registered, one of the descriptions that I offer that's kind of like an overview or I would say kind of an overview or taking pieces from different literatures that are trying to essentially define transformational learning. I write that it's a process that results in significant and irreversible changes in the way a person experiences, conceptualizes, and interacts with the world. So there's this idea that when our students are experiencing transformation or growth in the classroom, that it's like this internal shift. There's a change in terms of their consciousness. There's a shift in terms of perspective, that something is kind of clicking or moving for them. Some of the literature, again, you know, this can be an immediate thing where it's like this aha moment. Some of the literature describes it as like, you know, a light bulb goes on. And in this case, students will oftentimes kind of verbalize this shift that they're experiencing. But then again, other times it can be this more kind of incremental kind of progress or small changes over time over the course of a semester. So an important point here is that when transformation is occurring in the classroom, oftentimes it can be gradual or it can be a process. So there's a process to this maturation. Another way I like to think about it is that oftentimes we're sowing seeds for our students. We're kind of helping them to set a foundation. Hopefully it'll be a strong or an anchored foundation, but a lot of times we won't necessarily see the bloom or the growth until potentially another semester. Or if we only get the chance to have our students for one semester, maybe another faculty member will be the recipient of that growth. For instance, just this week in my classes, we were going through APA format, and I was going through the process of showing students how to access scholarly sources via QCC's website in the library so that they can kind of distinguish between what's a scientific journal article versus, you know, a more pop cultural source. And as we were going through the process, this was in my general psych course, it's a 101 class. It's a writing intensive class, but the nature of the class, they don't have the opportunity to write in-depth papers. And so we were going through APA format, source citation, and I was walking them through how to access and kind of read through these scholarly sources. But I was telling them, you know, this is a skill that's going to build. You're not necessarily going to have to access or start reading these articles this semester. But I saw kind of part of my purpose or obligation as an intro, course, as a faculty member for an intro course to psychology, to kind of sow those seeds for students so that when they progress to an upper level class where they'll be expected to access scholarly journals or to write papers and document their sources, they'll kind of have already gotten that foundation. So in a similar way, oftentimes that kind of transformation, it's happening incrementally. And this is an important point, which, you know, I think we all experience this over a course of a semester. A lot of times that transformation can even be precipitated by frustrations or challenges to content that students are exposed to in the class. As we know, you know, in terms of our own personal lives, a lot of times the most transformative growth or shifts that we experience in our own lives is after something uncomfortable or maybe even difficult to work through. And so in the same way, students can have a transformative experience following potentially a setback or a challenge in the classroom in terms of content or expectations that are placed on them, for instance. And what I would say is that while the potential for transformation and learning can happen at any phase as a student, higher education in particular has a lot of potential, because what the literature suggests is that there has to be a certain level of cognitive sophistication for this type of growth to be stimulated in an academic environment. And given the fact that we're dealing with a more mature student body in a higher education context, and for the most part, it's voluntary. Individuals are choosing to further their education in higher education contexts. This really leaves our classrooms particularly ripe for stimulating this growth or change. And a lot of times this can happen by being exposed to something in a new way. So it could be, and this is where I love, Myrna, I think you were the one that wrote unlearning. That can happen as well, right? It could be that a student had been exposed to something earlier in their educational progression, but maybe now they're being exposed to it in a new way, in a more complex way, maybe in a more challenging way, or maybe even we're doing a course correction for something that they were exposed to in a deficient or not entirely accurate way. And so that can, and that process of unlearning, kind of confronting something that I believe to be true or one way, and now I'm being exposed to it and confronted with this challenge that maybe what I assumed to be true or what I thought was true for the last 15 years of my knowing isn't true, that can be really disconcerting. So that could also be the type of challenge or frustration that serves as a catalyst for this type of growth or maturation. So it's not just being exposed to new material, it could be the perspective in which a topic is exposed to our students could allow them to see something in a new light or in a way that they hadn't considered before. And I think that that's a great segue into the third question that I wanted to pose. Victoria, if you don't mind the third slide. Thank you. Oh, no, no, no. I'm sorry. Go back. You were right. Yeah, thank you. So now we're going to look specifically at Holocaust education and how this can serve as a catalyst for that growth. You know, I've been teaching the Holocaust for quite a long time now in higher education. And when, you know, Laura mentioned in the intro that some years ago, I was the scholar in residence at the KHC. And so for those of you who got exposure to the article that you were all sent after being registered, you might've already read this, or if you took a look at the abstract, you maybe got a brief description of this. But basically that academic year, the research that I embarked in was I wanted to study and see how exposure to the Holocaust could have potentially stimulated change for our students who participated in our colloquium series that semester, that academic year. And this is where I started to realize that there is a very robust literature that identifies how essential Holocaust education is in an academic environment, not just in higher education, but across the board. There's also a very robust literature identifying what transformational learning is and how we can stimulate transformation or growth for our students. But what I realized was missing is that there isn't a very well-developed bridge between the two. And so I started to think about, well, how can Holocaust education serve as that particular catalyst or exposure that leads to meaningful change in our students? For those of you who have been teaching the Holocaust, which I imagine if you were interested in signing up for this, you probably already have some background in this. Do you have any ideas about how Holocaust education can serve as a bridge in terms of the transformational learning literature before I kind of dive into what I plan to talk about? Yeah, thank you, Marissa. Absolutely. And that's actually a good segue for the first question that I wanted to attempt to answer here, which is why the Holocaust? Like, why in particular is the Holocaust potentially ripe to kind of trigger this transformation? And I would say, similar to what Marissa wrote in the chat, the scale and scope is far-reaching. One of you mentioned earlier in the chat the significance of applicability, and unfortunately, we see the resonance of a lot of facets to this particular genocide in present day, which I'll elaborate on shortly. I would also say, from the perspective of being exposed to something that we think we know, but in a new way, or that gets us to question what we believe to be true, that it's a historical topic that many people think they know about, but that really lends itself to greater depth and complexity in terms of exploration. So for instance, one of the themes that I found when I was diving into the transformational learning literature, that's also true for Holocaust education, is the same way that the potential for maturation kind of never ends in the classroom, and there's always that potential. If any of you have had adult learners, I'm sure you've experienced this. Some of the most I would say engaged and eager students that I've had at QCC have been our adult students that are significantly older. And they're such a testament to this idea that the potential to constantly learn and mature and change is always there in each of us. Similarly, Holocaust education, it's lifelong. I think even those of us who are, immersed in this field of study, it's not like there's ever a point where we're like, okay, I know everything there is to know. I mean, I could share, just since the KHC exhibit about the concentration camp system has been up, when I was walking through the exhibit today, there were still things that I was looking at that I was like, wow, this is really opening my eyes to just kind of like the scale and the scope of the concentration camp system and this atrocity. So both of these processes, the process of being exposed to the Holocaust, the potential for maturation and growth and change when we're learning in higher education, these are both potentially lifelong processes. With the Holocaust in particular, there's a lot of popular culture and mass media depictions, particularly in American culture. And that's kind of a double-edged sword. Popular cultural depictions, it leads to greater awareness and dialogue regarding the Holocaust. But as we know, as academics, anytime something becomes particularly trendy or popular in the culture, there's always that risk of dilution or inaccuracy in terms of its portrayals. So to share with you all, over the course of that research I was doing that article is based on, I would ask students in interviews how expert they felt they were in terms of their understanding of the Holocaust. And I found it kind of interesting that some students who said they considered themselves very expert on the Holocaust, when I had asked kind of, was this based on another class that you've had as a student here at KH, at QCC, or what exposure was this based on? A lot of them would say things like, oh, you know, I've seen Schindler's List, or I've watched a lot of films about the Holocaust. And interestingly, that experience led to a lot of students reporting that they felt like they had a high level of competency or expertise on the topic. Students were far more likely to say that popular culture depictions that they had consumed led them to think they were experts than to say that they felt like they were experts because they were learning about the Holocaust in an academic environment. And I think that also tells us we have an imperative as faculty, because if we're not teaching the Holocaust in our classrooms, students are going to be getting that exposure somewhere else in the culture. And it's not necessarily going to be as nuanced or potentially even as accurate or vetted. So there's a lot of mythologies or misconceptions regarding the Holocaust. There can be problematic Holocaust exposure, whether it's pop cultural or even in other educational context. So that also brings me back to Myrna's comment of unlearning. There is the potential in a higher education context to course correct if there had been previous blind spots or problematic Holocaust exposure, which unfortunately, that's something that commonly occurs as well. The depth, the richness, and the complexity with which we can teach the Holocaust on a college level versus if our students had been exposed to it at an earlier academic or maybe even pop cultural level, is another reason why I would say Holocaust exposure, particularly at the college level, is really critical, because now students have more of a cognitive sophistication, a maturation, a kind of critical thinking foundation to be able to approach or confront the Holocaust in a way that's more in-depth than earlier exposures, which could potentially have been middle school, high school. It depends on what curriculum they were exposed to. In my experience with interviewing students, in terms of American curriculum, you're likely to have found some kind of exposure at the lower levels. But again, it varies depending on where in the United States, whether it was public or private. I've found at the college level for some of our international students who've been exposed to the Holocaust via our center or in a class at QCC, at least in terms of those that I interviewed, many of them had said this was their first exposure. So it is also possible, depending on the backgrounds of some of our students, that when we expose them to the Holocaust at a college level, it could be their first exposure. So that's really, somewhat disturbing to consider as well. But then the other side of that is that we can ensure a kind of strong foundation if we're their entry point or their first exposure to this atrocity. So I just want to make sure that there are no questions as we go on. So I was attempting to answer that why question of the Holocaust. I also, and I think maybe this is the point that maybe a lot of us had signed up for. I want to elaborate on the how. So how can we teach the Holocaust to our students in a way that enables this kind of stimulation, this growth, this shift in consciousness that we're seeking? What I found, which I elaborate on extensively in that article, is that using a particular theoretical framework or perspective through which we filter or present the Holocaust to our students is really critical. For those of you who've taught this topic before, you know that it can be overwhelming, it can be really vast. It's again, going back to the scale and scope of it. And so if you can offer a very specific framework as the pathway or the entry point into the Holocaust to help students anchor and conceptualize it, that is going to go a long way in furthering their understanding and also in presenting the atrocity in a way that allows for greater complexity and exploration. And as part of that, I would say it's also really important to override or to challenge common mythologies. And that's getting at greater complexity or depth. So for instance, some of the common stereotypes that students have going into this is, you know, all Nazis were evil, or that Hitler was the architect and everyone else was just kind of blindly following him, or this was something distinct to, you know, Germans at that time period. This is something that could never happen again, for instance. And, you know, when we look at something like the exhibit at the KHC and you look at the extent, the scale and the scope of the concentration camp system, and you see that there were actually 44,000 of these camps throughout Nazi Germany and occupied territories, you get a sense of, well, how can we just say that one man was responsible for these? He wasn't at all of those camps, right? And so even that, you know, I'll ask my students, do a little trivia with them. How many of these camps do you think that they were? And usually students will say like, oh, maybe four or five. Maybe a more ambitious student will say 100, 150. But when you get to that kind of number and scale, that in and of itself is very eye-opening. It's such an enormous kind of number to fathom. And then also a lot of times there, students might come in with these kind of simplistic or binary notions of there were the good guys and the bad guys. So there were the perpetrators, there were the victims, and then there were the liberators that were the allied powers. And, you know, as you start to kind of break down and talk more in depth regarding, you know, survivor experiences or the reality of, you know, the extent to which the atrocities were well known and things like that as they were ongoing, there starts to be a lot of discomfort in terms of recognizing it's hard to draw lines, you know, going back to that issue of fluidity, even, you know, the categorizations of who is a perpetrator versus, you know, at what point does a bystander who's helping to contribute to the concentration camp system, at what point are they now collaborative or also, you know, gaining perpetrator status, for instance? So those kind of questions trigger a lot of discomfort among students. Because again, you have this sense of America is the great liberator, but what about the fact that, you know, the international community by and large closed their borders and didn't allow Jewish refugees and, you know, other groups that were attempting to flee Nazi persecution safe harbor? You know, how do you reconcile that with the idea of us as the great liberator? So you start to see this discomfort or this kind of questioning of what I thought to be true. And that can serve as that kind of entry point to shifting consciousness or to shifting perspective, for instance. I think it's really important, and this is philosophically profound or challenging, but it's really important to override. There's this temptation to kind of separate or detach our own humanity from the humanity of the Nazis, or to kind of do this separation of, well, you know, they were Nazis. That's something that Nazis do. Because, you know, and oftentimes pop cultural depictions, they kind of reinforce this stereotype of the Nazi as absolute evil. And that's very convenient because then it allows us to kind of separate our own humanity or recognize the humanity and the perpetrators. I'm sure you're all familiar, for instance, with, you know, at the same time that that Nazism was popular in Europe in the early 1930s, that there was a really prominent eugenics movement here in the United States, and that partially influenced that infamous Tuskegee study that was done during this time period, or that began at least, on African-American males in the South here, where, you know, essentially they were being lied to regarding their treatments of syphilis, and the full disclosure of what was being done to them was not happening. Wild violation of medical ethics. And this persisted through the 1970s. So it persisted even after we had defeated Nazism and Nazi medical experiments had come to light. The reason that I mention this is recently I encountered a really provocative quote where one of the architects and participants in the Tuskegee study by the name of Dr. Cutler, if you want to look this up, he actually ended up going to Guatemala with funding from our government to continue experiments on the Guatemalan population. But actually, unlike what was done here in the United States, he actually developed a program where incarcerated individuals there were given syphilis against their will. They were injected with syphilis, or they purposely had brothels set up where the prostitutes had syphilis so that they would transmit it to men who went to these facilities, because they wanted to continue studying what would happen if syphilis went untreated. And he was actually tracked down recently by a researcher and kind of asked this question of, you know, in light of what was going on, you know, in the late 40s, the 50s, there was, you know, exposure of all these Nazi medical experiments and things like that. And you participate, like, basically, how could you justify or kind of reconcile, as our country was kind of condemning these atrocities that were done somewhere else, that you were engaging in similar types of, you know, violation of human rights? And I was so struck by this quote because I think it really gets to that, you know, detaching humanity for convenience sake. Dr. Cutler's response is, "I'm not a Nazi. You know, what I was doing is nothing like what they were doing." So that kind of blind spot in terms of, we so elevated, if you will, the type of evil that was perpetrated within this regime, that we don't recognize. We don't recognize the parallels or the precipitating factors or the atrocities when they're happening in our own backyards, or when we ourselves are perpetuating that. This is a really difficult thing philosophically for students to wrap their heads around. But this idea of, if we can get them to start thinking about, these are not monsters, what they did was monstrous, but ultimately they are humans, same as you and I. Again, that's a disconcerting reality, but that can also trigger a bit of that shift in terms of, I thought that I understood this, and maybe now I'm a little bit uncomfortable with the truths that are being revealed here. The messiness of this genocide and its precipitating factors and aftermath lend itself to depth and exploration of reflection that can really trigger shifts in consciousness and thinking for our students. And finally, I've been kind of hinting at this as well, this application to present day. It's critical to link this history with contemporary times so that students grasp the resonance and why understanding historical atrocities matter. And I think that in my experience, and when I was interviewing students, I found that the application piece, they could really relate to that. In fact, a lot of times I got the most engagement with students when I would ask them questions regarding, you know, when you think about the Holocaust, or what you were exposed to regarding the Holocaust during this NEH colloquium series, is there anything you could link it to present day? And I had students talking at that time about the Me Too movement, you know, atrocities that were occurring in Syria and other places in the globe. There was a very sophisticated exploration among students who I interviewed regarding kind of present day parallels. And this was pre-pandemic. If I'm remembering correctly, it was even pre-Trump administration. So I would argue, unfortunately, the resonance in parallel as we've seen these far-right movements exacerbated in our country and across the globe are even that much more timely and resonant than they used to be. Final question I wanted to pose, and this is a more practical one. Oh, go back. I'm sorry. One more. Thank you. How can you start to implement Holocaust education into your courses? And the article that I write goes more in depth regarding this kind of theme or theoretical orientation. Sorry, I'm just doing a quick time check. I want to share with all of you some additional themes that I've generated or I've conceptualized so that you can reflect on yourself. What would be an entry point that you would feel comfortable with, depending on the discipline that you're in? You know, one of the things that you find in the Holocaust education literature when faculty share their thoughts or their experiences or challenges regarding teaching the Holocaust is a lot of times there's this fear of presenting the Holocaust if faculty doesn't have a background in history because they feel as if they don't have expertise or they're not well trained. And while it's always important to have historical context, and you're very welcome, thank you. It's always important to have the basic historical context or recognition of chronology and things like that. You know, my discipline, I'm a social psychologist, I'm in social sciences. I can tell you, you don't necessarily have to have that background in history to be well qualified. Because again, of the scope and scale, there's so many different entry points that we can use to create a theoretical framework for our students that resonates with them, but that also is within our purview of expertise. So this is just a slice of that. It's in no way exhaustive, but this could potentially be helpful for each of you in terms of considering where would you feel comfortable given thank you, Meg, given the different courses that you teach, for instance, because what I also find is that my theoretical orientation or frame varies depending on what particular course that I'm teaching. So I came up with eugenics, American racism, stereotypes, radicalization of institutionalized discrimination, white supremacy, anti-Semitism. That's all its own kind of framework that you can use as an approach. This is something that could be political science oriented. I can use that frame within a social psychology or a sociology course, for instance. Criminalization of other. We actually, later on this semester, my colleague, Dr. Celia Sporer, is giving a talk on this topic. This is housed within criminal justice, but you can approach and present students the Holocaust from the perspective of Nazi policy and law, and look at how, with the passing of the Nuremberg laws, Jewish status was reduced and rights were slowly stripped away. And so this question of criminalizing certain groups, certainly homosexuality and other groups historically have been criminalized as well. And this is also something, unfortunately, that resonates with present day. Medical ethics, this is my entry point in my intro to psychology courses because we have a unit on research methods. So you can approach it from the perspective of the experiments that were done by Nazi doctors in the concentration camp system. I also connect this to the Tuskegee syphilis study, which was done during a similar timeline, but for far longer, actually, than the Nazi atrocities. I know that at our college with the nursing, with the nursing school, oftentimes this is their entry point for Holocaust education. Unfortunately, there was that extensive T4 program where the mentally ill and the disabled were also targeted and forcibly sterilized and oftentimes even killed. So that is an entry point you can include with medical ethics, or it could be its own entry point. That's the theoretical frame I have in my abnormal psych class. You could also, from the perspective of stigma, present this, because even to present day, mental illnesses like schizophrenia continue to be stigmatized. So I'll talk to my abnormal psychology students about how that legacy of stigmatization in its radicalized form, you see with the Nazi regime, that they start to systematically target and kill individuals that are housed in these asylums, for instance. There's actually a particular part of the exhibit at the KHC that looks at the T4 program as well. You can find that on the online exhibit as well. Bystander behavior, that's the next book that I'm working on. I'm looking at complicity and collaboration. That really gets to Marissa's point in the chat regarding kind of what was going on globally. And outside of the specifics of our particular community, the other side of complicity and collaboration that's not always considered is also rescue, resistance, nonviolence, and or pacifism. So you can also look at rescue efforts, nonviolent, resistant efforts. That is really eye-opening for students. The year that I was collecting my research, the KHC had this great exhibit on Le Chambon and helping. And most students, even who have been exposed to the Holocaust, they have virtually no exposure to the other side, which was the helping behaviors, the extraordinary stories of rescue. And just a couple more, and then we can wrap up because I wanted to leave time for any questions or answers. Media, propaganda, authoritarianism. This is a frame that could be approached as looking at threats to democracy, which is very resonant to the emerging far-right movement, not only in the United States, but across the globe. Political science, again, that's a frame that you can take. Sex and gender, sexual violence. This is also included in the KHC's exhibit as well. We've had colloquium series on the past. You can look at how males versus females were treated differently in the concentration camp system. There were also different roles assigned for perpetrators within the Nazi regime, depending on whether you were male or female. This system didn't really allow for LGBTQ or gender nonconforming, which is another reason why they were targeted and persecuted. So that's a very resonant entry point for students because they've all experienced gender socialization. So they can draw on their own experiences as respective men or women or, you know, whatever they identify as. Finally, I'll mention, because this is part of our theme this semester, refugee crises, internment, liberation, border policies. You can take an ethical, a philosophical, again, a political psychology, political science psychology frame here. But this question of who is worthy of being saved, what are the implications of closed border policies when a regime tilts increasingly away from democracy and towards authoritarianism and genocide? So again, that was me just generating different themes based on the years that we've had different series at the KHC and what I've read and encountered in the Holocaust education literature. Final slide to share. And this is actually, this is from a Lenquist article that I was asking Marissa to share with all of you if you want additional resources. He's a great scholar in the field of Holocaust education. I've gotten a lot of great literature from him. This is not quite as eloquent as the way that it's quoted, specifically in the Lenquist article that you'll all get access to. But he quotes a scholar who's approached with this question of how can you bear to teach the Holocaust? And the response is, how can we not? And I think that that really perfectly encapsulates the kind of essential role that Holocaust education can play in a liberal arts higher education environment. I know we don't have that much time left and some already had to log off, but I wanted to leave a little bit of time. If anyone had any questions or comments for me, please feel free to share.
Thank you, Ozzy. This has been amazing. And I actually do have a question.
Sure.
Because something that you said really resonated with me. And, you know, the importance of understanding the historical context, but not necessarily being hemmed in by that.
Right.
With our colleague, the curator in residence, Dr. Carrie Lane, for the exhibition, we've been looking also at Holocaust education. And one of the things that really comes out is the difference between teaching about the Holocaust versus teaching from the Holocaust.
Yeah.
About meaning getting really into the weeds on historical information, but how a historical perspective isn't necessarily the only thing to talk about. That in fact, when you're learning from the Holocaust, there's more generalizable insights that can be made. And I'm curious for you, in terms of helping students contextualize this in our current society, what do you think are lessons that faculty members and educators can use as sort of a guidepost when they're thinking about how do I integrate the Holocaust in courses ranging from English to history to psychology and so forth?
That's a great question. One of the mythologies of the Holocaust that I learned by interviewing students, which really disturbed me, is that more than one student said that they believed that the Holocaust was inevitable. And that while actions might have potentially delayed the extent of violence against the Jewish people, nothing could have stopped it. And that to me was particularly disconcerting to hear students saying, but it also kind of really emphasized for me that it's important to present the Holocaust from the perspective of a progression. I think a lot of times students come into it thinking, oh, you know, Hitler came into power and then the next day all of this stuff happened. And I think it's really important to identify that it was a slow progression. It was a regime that became increasingly radicalized, but that it's important to note that at every step of radicalization, this was actually a regime that was very sensitive to public sentiment and to international response. And so you can actually identify there were times when the regime was going in one direction, but then they got backlash or their own people started to turn against them. And so they turned away from a given policy. The T4 policy is a great example of this. And I think that a lot of times students also think that when it comes to a regime that's known as kind of like the ultimate evil or to have engaged in such an atrocity, that nonviolent tactics, that boycotts, that protests, that things like that can't happen. And that's because they're looking at the Holocaust or the regime from the perspective of the endpoint. They're not looking at where it started. And so it's really important to demonstrate what did Europe look like in the early 1930s? How did Hitler ascend to power? And then what were the series of kinds of early progressions against certain communities, for instance? And that's also an entry point to threats to our democracy here in the United States and to things that are happening globally right now. So I think that's an important historical context. But again, you don't necessarily need to be seeped in that history. It's more about the perspective that you offer when you're sharing the Nuremberg laws, when you're talking about what happens in the early 1930s. There are so many steps along the way where the international community, where bystanders within the country could have intervened. And there were times that they did that led to significant rescue and resistance. But of course, we know that it wasn't to as large of an extent as it could have been to save the millions of people that would ultimately end up perishing. But I think that really resonates with students because they can understand that in terms of their own experiences with, quite frankly, what's happening in America right now.
Thank you. I want to open up the floor to anyone else who may have some questions.
I also want to share that I'm very accessible over email. So, you know, if you read some of the articles that we share with you all after this, or if you start to reflect and think about how you want to design a particular assignment or maybe a lecture for one of your classes this semester or beyond, feel free to reach out to me. You can find me over email, and I'm happy to help in whatever capacity you think that I can be a resource.
I've definitely found, and you said this before, that students many times think that they are incredibly knowledgeable about the Holocaust. We ask all the time to interns, can you rate your knowledge on the Holocaust from 1 to 10? And they're like 7, 8. And I would say, after working at the center for almost 10 years, I'm still like a 2.
Yeah.
It always baffles me by how knowledgeable people think that they are. And it's like, you don't want to make them feel bad when you realize, like, you really know so little.
Yeah.
You have ideas for, like, you want to keep them excited and interested and eager to learn more, but you don't want to diminish what they've studied or viewed in terms of films. You don't want to diminish the research, the so-called research that they've done so far. What's the suggestions you have to kind of get them excited to, like, learn a little bit more and correct their understanding away from those?
No, that's a great question. In my experience, not just with this, but in most things in life, is that individuals who claim expertise are probably the most in need of greater exposure, right? Because the more we get immersed in something, especially something like this with the scale and scope, the more we're like, oh dear God, there's so much more to learn, right? I have that feeling all the time as I'm reading, as I'm visiting, as I'm doing things. And I don't necessarily think that you have, and I'm sure that you don't do this anyways, but I don't think that you have to necessarily directly confront that perception of expertise. I think it really comes with, you know, the idea of exposing students to the Holocaust in a way that probably they hadn't been exposed to before. So even just the basic thing with the concentration camp exhibit at the KHC of the 44,000 number, virtually no student is going to know that. So even starting with something like that, that will open their eyes, and that will make them realize that, wait, the scope and scale of this is really great. And, you know, when Laura was going through the map with the video, there's also this sense of, you know, regionally, I feel somewhat competent in terms of an overall perspective regarding the atrocity. But if someone were to ask me about a specific city in Italy or a specific place on the map, that's not necessarily my area of expertise. So also recognizing kind of the scope and the scale, that there's always a lot more to learn, I think that that's helpful. And oftentimes it's, you know, so the 44,000 number, the talking about Le Chambon or rescue and resistance, these are things that are lesser known and lesser depicted aspects of the Holocaust. And so if you include those types of things in the exposure, then students, I think, on their own will start to grasp that, wow, there's a lot more to this story. Or, you know, I think a lot of times, especially our American students, there's this idea of our country as the great liberators, and they don't kind of realize how late we were in terms of our own interventions. And that can be really, really eye-opening and disconcerting. And, you know, just recently, for instance, I'm starting to read about, I didn't know the extent to which the genocidal policy and the Nuremberg laws were actually adopted based on American laws and eugenic policies. So that can also be really eye-opening for students, because I think we have this kind of mythology of our nation as the great liberators without recognizing, well, there's a lot of things we could have done a lot earlier in the game. So that can be another entry point that makes students realize that there's maybe more to the story than they originally realized, especially if they're primarily consuming American media when it comes to Holocaust depictions, right? Because we definitely have that mythology promoted in terms of our media here.
Thank you so much, Ozzy.
This of course.
Is really illuminating, and we're really, really grateful for your insights and also really being able to contextualize this, because so often our conversation is about the history and making the connections, but it's very important for us to be able to think about how we're educating and what are we talking about. And what are young people and students and visitors alike coming away with? And is this relevant in their lives? Thank you very much. This recording will be available on our website very soon, and we'll see all of you soon. Be well.
Thanks to all the participants for taking time. I know you're all so busy right now. I appreciate it. Thank you.